You know, there's absolutely no question whatsoever that the justice system in the United States is deeply flawed. Not only are we allowing white-collar criminals to get away with murder, and sometimes that's quite literal, but the rate at which innocent people are going to prison should give every law-abiding citizen a reason to be worried. Joining me now to discuss the problem of wrongful convictions is Mark Godsey. He's the author of the new book, Blind Injustice, law professor at University of Cincinnati, director of the Innocence Project of Ohio. Mark, thank you for joining us today. And I have to tell you, look, this is a very important issue here when talking about wrongful convictions in the United States. We have a lot, mostly on the right, people tell us that, yeah, we have a lot of people in prison because there's a lot of people committing crimes. That's not always the case, is it?
No, I mean, I think that universally everyone thought that, you know, 30 years ago, but, you know, both the right and the left now, particularly before Trump came into office, we're pretty much in agreement that the criminal justice system needs to be reformed in two ways. One is the problem of mass incarceration, which, you know, even like, you know, right-wing Republicans who are worried about the finances and the cost of incarceration, that started getting, you know, their attention. So they started falling in line with that. And the second major thing is wrongful conviction. We have far too many people who are innocent being sent to prison, being sent to death row. And so in both respects, we've come to this sort of crossroads in the past 10 years where everyone's sort of realizing we've been doing things the same way for 200 years, and we're now starting to see some real problems. Trump and Sessions have set that back a little bit, but you know, prior to that, I think there was bipartisan support for criminal justice reform, and you know, right up there is the need to reform the criminal justice system to make it more accurate.
Well, you know, about a decade ago, we were looking at, you know, anywhere between about 12 and 24 people every year in the United States finally being exonerated after spending time in prison for crimes they didn't commit. But recently, last 2, 3, 4 years, we're literally starting to see hundreds every year.
Yeah.
Convictions overturned.
Single year. Yeah, it goes up every single year with no signs of failing off at all. And the crazy thing is that the people who are lucky enough to be exonerated, we know that's just the tip of the iceberg, because the vast majority of people in prison who claim innocence aren't lucky enough to have DNA in their case, or, you know, the police have thrown it away in the 20 years they've been in prison. The witnesses are dead. And so, you know, it's a small percentage where all the pieces and all the stars have to be in a line where you can go back and reinvestigate the case and prove them innocent. So, you know, we've proved thousands innocent in the past couple of decades to the innocence movement. We know that's literally just the tip of the iceberg, which is really heartbreaking if you think about it.
Well, what's really interesting about this, I guess you'd call it a phenomenon of people being wrongly convicted, is how far we've come with scientific advancements. You know, DNA evidence, all kinds of new forensic sciences out there. You would think, and I know a lot of people assume that because of this, it would be nearly impossible to convict somebody for a crime that they didn't commit because of, you know, they watch these television shows where they go in there, they run the DNA and the results are back in 5 minutes and they've got a facial recognition. But the real criminal justice system is nothing like that whatsoever. But people have this warped view of it because science has advanced, but certainly not to the level that we see on television. And so
well,
I think that plays,
you know,
a role in what people,
you know, what's
perceive.
Ironic is you've got these shows out there like CSI that are painting this picture that the state of forensics in this country is like putting man on the moon, like it's some miracle. But actually, wrongful convictions are caused by bad forensics. I mean, nothing could be further from the truth. There couldn't be more of a Hollywood myth than the state of the forensics in this country. I mean, we've got all kinds of junk sciences that are carryovers from previous decades or previous centuries even, that have never been validated through the scientific methods, that are very unreliable. And that's actually one of the main themes of my book, Blind Injustice. I spent several chapters talking about the state of forensics. You know, it's just not me saying it. I mean, in 2009, the National Academy of Sciences, which is an independent agency that advises Congress on scientific issues, established by President Lincoln, came out with a scathing report saying that, you know, look, we're convicting all these innocent people. These forensics are a big problem. They need to be validated. We need to relook at them again. The conclusions these scientists are sitting to in court are overblown. And, you know, really nothing's been done. At the end of the Obama administration, We started seeing some advances. They set up a commission, a federal commission, to study this and try to improve forensics. But Trump and Sessions came in and killed it. So, you know, it's really shocking. It's one of those situations where what the public believes and what the truth is are a complete disconnect. And, you know, we're still using these, like, outdated, unreliable junk sciences from, like, the 1930s in many cases. It's just shocking.
Well, and you know, what people need to understand, too, not that I want everybody walking around paranoid they're going to be convicted for something, but if you go over to a friend's house, you know, you get a drink, you have fingerprints on a cup, you touch their doorknob, you touch a door, anything in the bathroom, your fingerprints are there, your footprints are there. So, as you point out, forensic science is not always accurate because everywhere you go, everywhere everyone goes, you're leaving some kind of thing behind. Maybe it's a stray hair. Maybe, you know, it's a footprint or a fingerprint. So we do have to have our law enforcement officials do their due diligence on this and make sure that, okay, well, this person had a gathering and we've got 25 people's fingerprints here. Not everybody here is a suspect. So that's one aspect of it.
Yeah, but let me just tell you something else that I think you might find interesting. I mean, we give even like fingerprints this sort of like stamp of approval as if it's reliable. But confirmation bias is a psychological phenomenon I talk about quite a bit in the book, and it really plays a huge part in forensics. This psychologist out of London, H.C.L. Drawer, did this study where he took leading fingerprint experts across the country, and he said, look, I want you to look at this case where years ago a fingerprint expert testified that the defendant's fingerprint matched the fingerprints at the crime scene, caused him to get convicted, and we now know the guy's innocent. He wasn't even at the crime scene. We know the fingerprint expert made a mistake. Can you look at the fingerprints from that case and tell us where he messed up? And unbeknownst to each of these experts, what Drawer did is he went into their own files and pulled fingerprints that each expert had testified to was a match years before. Of course, they don't remember that this is a pair of fingerprints they looked at. You know, all they do is look at fingerprints all day long. So they didn't realize it was from their own case. And he's, you know, by setting it up differently and saying, look, this is a case where the fingerprint expert made a mistake, and then having them evaluated, he got 80% of the fingerprint experts to flip their answers and say, this is not a match. You know, this is not the same guy that doesn't match the fingerprint from the crime scene. And it's like, surprise, this is from one of your cases. You can't testify 10 years ago and cause this guy to get convicted. So it just goes to show, and, you know, this has been proven over and over again, that confirmation bias, if you set up the context before and, like, the police and prosecutors tell the fingerprint expert or the CSI experts, look, this guy's guilty. We know the fingerprints are going to match, or we know the bite mark's going to match, or we know the bullet's going to come from his gun. It actually affects their minds. It affects what they see, and it affects the outcome. And so, you know, one of the things we've got to do is we've got to do a blinding process where the experts aren't told in advance what the right answer is, which is just a basic tenet of the scientific method. So, you know, there's a lot of simple reforms we can do to make this more accurate, which we're not doing.
Absolutely. And we need to take a quick break here. When we come back, you know, we've talked about the science here. We need to get into the other side a little bit, too. We need to talk about the role that prosecutors are playing in some of these wrongful convictions. So stay with me for just a moment. We're going to take a quick break. I'm Farron Cousins, and for Sam Cedar, we'll be right back with more Ring of Fire Radio.